Hey, it's Meatball.
And Mark.
And this is the Rocker Morning Show on demand from 107.7 RKR. 107.7 RKR, it is the Rocker Morning Show with Meatball.
And Mark Frankhouse.
Good morning, Mark.
Good morning, bro.
How are you?
Doing great.
Ready for the weekend, ready for a good time, some live music tonight.
Yes, going to Warner Vineyards in Pawpaw, getting people registered for the Rocker Rides. Got some good barbecue out there, got some good rock music. It's going to be awesome, man. That's the place to be tonight if you're not going to the big show later on.
Oh, yeah. Alice Cooper tonight. Oh, I love Alice Cooper. Yeah. I told you the story about taking my folks to see him in Deep Purple in Texas, right?
Yeah.
Oh, my God. I still don't understand why they put Alice Cooper before Deep Purple. Because, I mean, the crowd's already covered in confetti and streamers and banners and whatnot, and then they have to stand there for... trust me, Deep Purple sounded awesome.
Oh, yeah, no doubt.
But after that...
Yeah, it's just kind of a weird lineup because, again, when I saw Alice Cooper, he opened up for Iron Maiden, so...
Oh, yeah.
That,
yeah.
You know, that fits perfectly.
Yeah.
But, yeah. Putting him before Deep Purple, it's like, how do we follow that?
Yeah,
we don't. We just go out there and do our thing.
Well, I don't know what you got up to last night, but again, I am all in on the Olympics. I think Flava Flav is officially bankrolling like half the Olympics right now, half the U.S. team. You knew he was bankrolling the water polo team.
Yes.
That's been pretty public of him, like, in the pool, learning how to play and wearing the hat and everything.
Right.
Like, he's been able to blast with that. I think he brought Spike Jones to a match the other day, which is pretty funny. Well, some other athletes there for Team USA who are on, like, the track team. So not necessarily the famous runners, but, like, the shot put people, the discus people. Like, these are like, college kids, basically.
Right.
And they're college track teams. One in particular, one of the discus throwers was like, I can't even pay my rent. And I'm training to be an Olympian here. The university's only going to cover a certain percentage or whatever my rent.
It's embarrassing.
Flava Flav hopped into her DMs, is like, hit me up. I got you, fam. Like, he is seriously, like, the greatest person ever. One of the strangest people ever. But, like, who paid your rent this month? Some dude with a giant clock around his neck.
Yeah.
What was his name? Oh, I know that because he said it like 12 times. Flava Flav.
Mr. Flavor.
Mr. Flava. Jeez,
yeah,
man.
Yeah, it's pretty bad when Mr. Flavor is taking care of your finances as opposed to the school. But
you know, or, you know, literally, like, a lot of the other countries, the government kind of, like, helps bankroll that stuff. And I'm sure there's an element of that here, but...
I don't know, Meatball, that... I wasn't great in biology, but I don't think that element's been discovered yet.
Oh, that's fair enough. That's fair enough.
I think we might need Tony Stark to create that element.
I was talking yesterday. One of my favorite things to watch is the walk race, which was happening right as the show was ending yesterday.
What a goofy looking race.
And you were in the room like while I was learning, because I'm making it a note to pay attention to the rules of the stranger sports this year to like really learn how they're done.
Yeah.
I learned all about like walk races have penalty boxes. Like the whole goal is to keep your feet, you have to be touching the ground at all times.
Yeah.
If at some point you hop off the ground, like you're running or skipping or something, you get like a yellow card or a red card and you go stand in a penalty box for 2 minutes.
Man. So funny.
That was a ton of fun. And then watching gymnastics last night, which we'll hit on later on, I realized... those athletes are incredible.
Yeah.
And I mean, not to say that I didn't already know that before, but like I'm watching them do stuff on, you know, the pommel horse and the bars and stuff, and I'm just like, oh God, I hurt just watching that.
I think I need to lay down with an ice pack.
Yeah. The most gymnastics I do is roll out of bed every morning. Is there a gold medal for that?
Listen, there's a gold medal for walking. There's got to be one for rolling.
You know, that's a fair point, Mark. 107.7 RKR, it is the Rocker Morning Show with Meatball.
And Mark Frankhouse.
When you think of pickles, is there a brand that comes to mind?
There's only one brand that comes to mind.
And that is?
The one with the ostrich or the stork or whatever.
Yeah, the stork on it. The ostrich. Yes, Vlasic. It is a stork, by the way, and I'll get to that in a second.
Like, literally, like, paintball to my gut.
Yeah.
Do you tell me to name another pickle company?
Oh, Clausen. Clausen.
Oh.
Yeah.
I'd catch a paintball right in the gut.
And then Meyer, Kroger, they all have their own. But anyway, yeah, Vlasic. Vlasic is the end-all, be-all as far as, like, pickles are concerned. Their whole point is it's the best pickle you ever had, you know, because it's got the stork and he uses the pickle like a cigar.
Groucho Marx voice. Yeah,
he's got like a Groucho Marx voice, right? it's the best pickle you'll ever had, you know? Supposedly, these pickles have the best crunch to them. They're a Polish-style pickle. They started in Michigan.
I didn't know that.
So the gentleman who started it, his last name is Vlasic. He was Polish. He was not really Polish. He was from basically where Hungary is, that area.
Right. He was like Austrian and Hungarian.
Yeah. Yeah. Immigrated to Detroit and actually started a creamery with his son initially, but they got into making their homemade Polish style pickles. So they started doing that. And then during World War II, they started putting them in glass jars and distributing them. And the company just exploded from there because people were doing food rations at the time. And pickling was a great way to save your food, doing it in glass jars. And so people were not only buying the pickles, they were saving the glass jars. And so Vlasic was on their mind. And boom, Vlasic pickles became the end all be all when it came to pickles. Great timing, great product too. And as we know, Vlasic is now one of the largest brands. Now owned by Campbell Soup Company, and it's incredible. But it got started in Imlay City.
Oh yeah, yeah. I think Imlay City was the first. I think that's where the first plant was.
Yes, that is where the first plant for packaging, producing, and creating the pickles was created.
Gotcha. I knew they had setups in Michigan. I didn't know that they like originally started.
Yep.
Now, that's pretty wild.
Let's talk about how pure Michigan Vlasic pickles actually are. You would think, you know, a multi-international, you know, company right now worth probably billions of dollars and blah, blah, blah. They just get, you know, their cucumbers and everything they use for pickling from everywhere, right? No. All the cucumbers they use for Vlasic pickles. So every Vlasic pickle you have ever eaten or ever will eat comes from two places. Mount Pleasant and Kalamazoo.
Wow, that's pretty sweet.
Yeah, man.
You're eating those Kalamazoo pickles.
That's pretty awesome. Like,
especially coming from Celery City.
Yeah, right?
You know?
We should be, like, instead of focusing on, you know, pizza and cereal, like, the state should be focusing on how awesome our pickles are.
Yeah, what's the deal with that?
Did you really just do that?
What? I didn't do it. No, this is pretty sweet.
We weren't going to do pickle puns today, okay? No, but it was very cool. I stumbled across this and was like, oh, Vlasic is a Michigan company. Oh, everything's still made here. Oh, it's all literally coming directly from the area.
That's really cool.
Now, as to talk about the stork, this might be a little out of date. Do you know why they use a stork?
No.
What's one of the most common foods that pregnant women tend to crave
pickled
things and stuff? That's where they got the idea. It's like, oh, pregnant women love pickles. Let's put a stork on there.
Yeah, I don't know about that.
That's that's maybe the only questionable thing about all this. Yeah, now that you know that, you kind of look at it a little different. But at the same time, like... a stork with a Groucho Marx accent using a gherkin as a cigar. Telling you it's the best pickle you ever had, you know, like it's all ridiculous and it's all about pickles, man. Pure Michigan, baby.
A mental magnitude of your favorite morning monkeys on the radio. And now, your hosts for the Daily Five, Meatball and Mark Frank Howes.
It is the Daily Five where Mark and I ask each other questions. The other one answers. Today, I'm asking the questions. Mark is answering. Mark, you got some help on the line today from Jeff. Good morning, Jeff. How are you?
I'm doing good. Thank you.
Awesome, man. You got to help me get 3 out of 5 questions correct. If you do, we'll take the 4-1 win for the week. If not, Meatball will scrounge up that second point for the week.
All right. Question number one. This has to do with jobs. What does an apiarist do? Do they tend to bees, repair pianos, or nothing?
Apiarist.
You want me to spell it?
I'm going to guess pianos.
Yeah, I think it's pianos. I think you're right. Nothing. You know what, though? Yeah, I bet you it's like, I bet you it is. You know what? Here's my thought, Jeff, because Meatball's kind of a turd sometimes. I bet you we're probably right, but the other side of that coin is Meatball tweaked the name a little bit.
Let me just be clear here. No. I just want to make sure that I'm not like, you know, pulling the wool over your eyes here. Apiarist in this form is spelled correctly as what it is. And by nothing, I don't mean it is nothing. I mean that an apiarist does nothing.
Oh, okay. Gotcha.
Yes.
Thank you.
So what does an apiarist do? Tend to bees, repair pianos, or nothing?
We're going to go with pianos. If Jeff, you're cool with that, pianos, final answer.
Going pianos, final answer. No, an apiarist tends to bees.
Ah, he's a beekeeper.
Got all worked up for no reason.
No, I'm just, you know, we can't trust each other anymore on this game.
Question number two, this is geography. Where is the lowest point in the United States? Is it in the Florida Keys, Death Valley, or Waikiki, Hawaii?
Isn't it Death Valley, Jeff?
I would say so, yes.
All right, Death Valley, final answer.
At 282.2 feet below sea level, it is Death Valley.
Wow.
Yeah.
Man, that's deep.
Did you fill that with water?
That's deep, yeah.
Question number three, this is music. What city is said to be home of the first ever performance of an electric guitar?
Ooh.
Is it Los Angeles, California, Osaka, Japan, or Wichita, Kansas? Electric guitars have been around for a while.
Japan jumped out at me, Jeff.
Yeah, I'm not sure on that one.
You got Yamaha out there, too.
Yeah, Yamaha. You got Wichita, Kansas, which is Meatball's home state, home city. And then Los Angeles?
Yep, that was the first
Yeah,
one.
I don't know. Jeff, I'm kind of feeling Japan on this one, man.
All right, I'll go along with it, but I kind of lean toward Wichita.
Wichita, huh? Okay, I mean, I'm down to run with you, Jeff. I'm riding with Team Jeff on this one. I'll go with Wichita, Kansas, final answer.
Wichita, Kansas, final answer. That is correct.
Wow. I didn't even know that.
It was created in L.A., but it was first performed by Cage Brewer in Wichita in 1932.
Whoa. You'll learn something new every day thanks to Jeff's genius brain.
All right. Question number four. And actually, if you get this one, you get the win. Sports.
Let's get it.
This is a little different, but I think you'll be fine.
Cool.
The U.S. has never medaled in 5 sports in the Olympics. Can you name 2 of them? I'm not giving you multiple choice, but I am going to give you some time to think here.
They've never medaled in five events.
Now, to be clear on this as well, this does not include brand new events, and it does not include events that don't happen anymore.
Gotcha. Well, this is interesting, Jeff.
Yeah. I can't think of that many sports.
Well, I'll take a stab at one of them. I'm going to say water polo. I'm actually blanking. I wish I could actually look at what events there are because
as you kind of move along here, and I'll give you a couple of minutes here to work through this, I'll give you some hints. None of them involve water.
Wow. Okay. Good Lord.
And if you get a little closer, I'll cue you in.
So
how about pole vaulting?
Pole vaulting?
Not a track event either.
What the hell? Okay.
I believe all 5 of these events take place indoors.
Okay. I'm going to say then, I'm going to say this, Jeff. I'm going to say trampoline. And I'm going to say, dance? Is there some kind of dance?
Dance. Can you be more specific? Like
choreographed dance or like improv dance? I can't remember there's some kind of dancing metal in the Olympics.
Are you talking in like the gymnastics area?
No, not gymnastics, because we know that they got medal there.
Well, not necessarily like overall, but like specific events.
Man, this is, I mean,
you
this
do
is
have
going
one of them. Trampoline
long.
Is one of them.
Okay, trampoline. We'll go, good Lord. Discus. Final answer.
Well, you got trampoline. I'll give you that one.
Oh my
Discus.
God.
I don't know.
Why was that the fourth question?
All right. Your answers are trampoline, which you got. I was so close with dancing. I was like, are you sure you don't want to go into gymnastics? Rhythmic gymnastics, table tennis, handball, and badminton. Those are the five events that we have never meddled in.
I wish I would have had a list of, because it wasn't just here, name the ones we haven't meddled in. It's here, remember all of the events in the Olympics.
Yeah, you can't do that. All right. Final question has to do with comics. Who was the first ever Marvel Comics superhero? Was it Iron Man, the Human Torch, or Captain Marvel?
Captain Marvel.
Captain Marvel.
1939 was the year.
Yeah, I think you're right. I think it's Captain Marvel, Jeff.
Yeah, that's what I'd go with.
Captain Marvel, final answer.
First appeared in Marvel Comics number 1 in 1939, which was then distributed by Timely Comics, the Human Torch.
Ah, the Fantastic Four.
That's the beginning of the Fantastic Four. That is correct.
Man, wild. Well, we couldn't get the fourth point for the week. Meatball gets the second point for the week. We end up 3-2. But, Jeff, congratulations. You are winning a VIP table for you and three friends tonight at the Arena Rock Show at Warner Vineyards in Paw Paw.
Awesome.
All right. Congratulations. Thanks for your help today, Jeff.
Yeah, no problem.
And we're actually giving away another VIP table to the first person that texts us VIP Warner to the chat button on the 107.7 RKR app. Text us VIP Warner on the chat button on the Rocker app, and you and three friends will also get a VIP table to tonight's show at the Arena Rock Show at Warner Vineyards in Paw Paw. 107.7 RKR, it's a Rocker Morning Show with Mark Frankhaus and Meatball, joined on the phone by one of the original VJs from MTV. Welcome to the Rocker Morning Show, Mark Goodman. Good morning, man.
Thanks for having me on, you guys. Appreciate
it. It is the 43rd anniversary of the launch of MTV. I'm curious how you feel about the evolution of the MTV channel going through the heavy video years of the 80s and 90s to the reality era to where it is now.
Yeah, MTV is to blame for reality television. I'm sorry. It was not my choice. But, the evolution of it is, in a way, it kind of hurts. I don't watch it anymore. There's no reason for me to watch it. I don't like reality TV. I don't need to see any, I don't care about that stuff. And even, I have a daughter who's 31 years old. When she was a teenager, I didn't really want her watching. There was all this, 16 and pregnant and all that stuff. So it sort of hurts that that's the way that it evolved, but they had to do that. Because of the nature of technology and the nature of the music business, it had to evolve into what it has become. There's no reason for a TV station 24/7 playing videos. We've got YouTube. No need for it anymore.
Yeah. Were you passionate about the music back then? Were you passionate about any specific genre of music or rock at all?
The reason that I got into radio was because I sucked as a musician.
I feel you.
I was so passionate about the music. And in fact, when I quit the radio station in New York, the reason that I did it was because it was an AOR station, album oriented rock. So the playlist, you knew what it was. It was the Beatles, the Stones, Led Zeppelin, the Who. And I'm sorry. In 1979, there was a lot more going on in music than that. And when I quit in 1980, I quit or 81 rather, I quit because I was looking for what I called the new underground. I wanted to know, I wanted to play the amazing music that was happening that wasn't getting played.
Right.
Just by a stroke of luck, this MTV thing came along, and what would we play? But music by these obscure bands, because that's who was making the video.
Yeah.
Great.
That's awesome. So you literally got to transition your career right to what you wanted to do. So you kind of revitalized your career in a sense.
Well, I mean, look, you guys are in radio. You know what it is.
Yeah.
If you get a job at the number one station in the number one market in the country, that's it. You're not going anywhere.
Yeah. Right. Yep.
And, you know, when I told my friends that I was going to quit, you know, 7 months into my contract, to go to cable television, they thought I was insane.
Yeah.
Worked out okay.
Anybody who wants to know more about the early days of MTV, Mark also co-authored the book VJ, The Unplugged Adventures of MTV's First Wave, which is available on Amazon, anywhere you can get books. Also, Sound Up with Mark Goodman and Alan Light, wherever you can get your podcast. Also, 80s on the 8 and Classic Rewind. Mark, it was a blast talking to you. Thanks for being part of something special that was special to us growing up, and thanks for joining us today.
Yeah, thank you so much, man.
Thanks, both of you. Really appreciate you having me on, man. Have a great day.
You too.
See you, Mark.
You can listen to the full podcast on the 107.7 RKR app. Clicking that on-demand button, you're going to want to check this out. He's going to talk about when he was on air as a radio DJ in New York the night John Lennon was murdered. And man, this is an incredible story.
107.7 RKR, it is the Rock and Morning Show with Meatball.
And Mark Frankhouse.
Well, Mark, it's after 8 o'clock, and we have quite possibly the greatest promotion, the greatest giveaway in all of Southwest Michigan, and all of Michigan, and quite possibly the entire country.
I don't think anybody else has given away a lease on a brand new Ford F-150 or Chevy Silverado like Tapper Automotive and Papa is. Putting you behind the wheel for 2 years. They're financing it all themselves. These vehicles are amazing. We're giving you tons of different ways to get registered. So let's go down the list. Tonight, you're looking for something to get into. You're looking for some good barbecue, some good beers, some good music. The best place outside of the Alice Cooper Show is at Warner Vineyards in Paw Paw. We're going to be out there for the Arena Rock Show from 6 to 8, getting you registered for the Rocker Rides. Nowhere else you'd rather be. Also, you can get registered with us on all of our stops. You can click the Rocker Rides button on the 107.7 RKR app and WRKR.com. That'll give you a list, all the dates, locations, times where you can get registered. Also, right around this time, Monday through Friday, 8 to 10. So let's get you registered for the Rocker Rides, 978-1077. Caller number 7, you're getting registered and getting you behind the wheel for 2 years in a brand new Ford F-150 or Chevy Silverado, all thanks to our friends at Tapper Automotive in Paw Paw.
107.7 RKR, it is the Rocker Morning Show with Meatball.
And Mark Frankhouse.
All right, it's time for our Olympics update from yesterday.
Oh,
gymnastics, yeah. Dominant again for the U.S. Simone Biles, supported by her family and her husband, Bear Safety Jonathan Owens, in the crowd. In the individual all-around events last night, taking home the gold, her 9th, which is the most ever by an American gymnast. She is also the oldest gymnast to win a gold at the age of 27. Her American team partner and gold medalist from last Olympics, Suni Lee, taking home the bronze. Silver went to gymnastics powerhouse Rebecca Andrade from Brazil. In men's rowing, the U.S. men's team took home the gold medal, finishing less than a second ahead of last Olympics champion New Zealand. This was the first gold by the U.S. men's team since 1960 and redemption after failing to medal 3 years ago for the first time in the history of the U.S. and the Olympics. Switching over to swimming, Katie Ledecky, now the most decorated woman swimmer in Olympic history with 13 medals, winning a silver in the 4x200-meter freestyle relay with the women's team last night. She got another chance at gold tonight as well, which would tie her Soviet gymnast Larissa Latynina, I think I'm saying that right, Latynina, for the most golds ever won by a woman in the Olympics. She also announced her intentions to swim in L.A., in the Olympics of 4 years, which would almost assuredly make her not just one of the most decorated women in Olympics history, but all Olympic athletes. Speaking of Ledecky, before she became the GOAT, she was being babysat by the GOAT. We found this out yesterday. Video has surfaced of little baby Katie Ledecky in a media box at a game in Washington, probably at a Wizards game, and Michael Jordan in the box with her playing peekaboo with Ledecky, who might have been one at the time. Her uncle was a business partner with Jordan when they bought part of the Capitals and Wizards together.
That's wild.
So, yeah. If only Jordan knew all those years ago that she was that he was playing peekaboo with the eventual GOAT. All right, medal count as of 8 o'clock this morning. Actually, as of just a little bit ago, Eastern time in the U.S. Finally, officially, the U.S. has snuck into the top three in the medal count. China still leading the way with 12 gold, 7 silver, 7 bronze, 26 total. U.S. now up to 9 gold medals after men's rowing and Simone Biles' incredible performance yesterday. 16 silvers, 14 bronze, still leading overall race with 39 medals in total. France adding a bronze this morning. They have 8 gold, 11 silver, 28 total. Australia coming in at 4th with 8 gold, 6 silver, 5 bronze, and 19 total. And Japan falling fast. 8 gold, 3 silver, 5 bronze, and 16 total medals.
Man.
Tonight's schedule, 15 medaling events going on. Men and women's rowing pairs. 3-meter springboard and diving, men's and women's trampoline, badminton, mixed doubles, judo, tennis mixed doubles, and track and field kicking off today with the men's 10,000-meter final. U.S. has games in 3x3 basketball, water polo, and beach volleyball today as well. U.S. men's soccer team playing Morocco in just a little bit, actually. And lots of swimming tonight, too, with Katie Ledecky looking to add to her medal count in the women's 800-meter freestyle event, her final time in the pool for these Olympics. So man, that is your Olympic breakdown for today, man.
USA could be in the lead by the end of the night.
I think that is entirely possible. Go Katie. 107.7 RKR. It is the Rocker Morning Show with Meatball.
And Mark Frankhouse.
And guest in studio. It's Friday, which means we've got to do Workplace of the Week with BC Pizza. And we have Zoe in the house. What's up?
Yeah.
What's up, guys?
How you doing this morning?
I'm pretty good. I have drank half my coffee, so I'm kind of awake.
Okay, are you used to being awake this early in the day?
No. I call this the most ungodly hour of the day.
Oh, come on. The sun is even up. Like,
I was wondering what that IV of coffee was all about. It was,
she came in with just a drip.
Exactly. I'm just...
Got it hooked up. Goes right into the bloodstream.
Exactly.
Well, Zoe, you're holding down the fort there at BC Pizza on West Main. What's going on over there? What's happening?
Yeah, so... we need to keep Dad in our thoughts and our prayers. He's not doing too well right now. Mm-hmm. So he's going to be taking a sabbatical for the next 3 months.
Gotcha.
He's going to be doing my dough and my sauce. Praise God. Hallelujah.
Ah, so now you're the boss.
I am the boss. So I'm taking over fully. Our updated hours are we're going to be closed on Sundays and Mondays so that I can have 2 days off and not be bald by the end of this. And then we're going to be updating our buffet hours. So Wednesday nights now, we're going to have a buffet as well. So Wednesday, Thursday nights, 5 to 7 starting next week. Awesome. And then we have our normal lunch buffet Tuesday through Friday, 11 to 2.
That's rad. Man, extra night of the buffet.
I know.
I'm
and that's doomed. That's one of the nights that I don't have a ton of work to do.
Right.
Sweet.
We're doomed.
Come eat all the pizza.
I just lost 10 pounds on vacation. I'm going to gain it all back in like 2 days.
And it's gone. Now, you brought a friend in with you to help you out today, correct?
Yeah.
Step in here.
Say hi,
it's a party.
Shay.
Hey, guys.
What's up?
It's me.
I just met Shay. Beautiful. You were here last week, right?
I wasn't here. I met Mark at Warner Vineyard.
Ah, yes. That's what it was. Okay.
She came out to get signed up for the Rocker Rides.
Nice.
I remember it was the Chevy Silverado. No,
it couldn't have been. It was the Ford, probably. It was probably the Ford. So we got to pick our workplace of the week here.
Yes.
Complete and appropriate subject change here. Zoe, you get to announce our workplace of the week. So let me get to the drum roll here. Because it's not
some anticipation.
Oh, that's okay. I was like, where are you going with that?
All right,
drum roll, please.
Our new workplace of the winner, a workplace of the week winner, is
Ascension Borges Cancer Center.
Yay!
Sam Knight, you have won workplace of the week. We are going to provide you a pizza party.
Sam Knight and all the great people over there at Ascension Borges Cancer Center, all the amazing work that you do, we're going to throw you a pizza party. So, Sam, if you're listening, give us a call at 978-1077. We'll get that info. We'll throw you a pizza party on Monday. Best way to start the week.
Fantastic. You guys hanging out for first beer of the weekend, right?
Yeah, we are.
Yeah.
Fantastic.
Woo crew.
The woo crew.
Beer in the morning.
We're doubling up, man. It's a good day.
I'm all about it. Set the needle and crank the knob. It's Mark Frankhouse, and I've got another crucial addition to your record collection. It's vinyl and 45 on the rocker. This weekend, I want you guys to check out the album Apostrophe by Frank Zappa, whose son Dweezil Zappa was a guest on our show this week. An edited version of its leadoff track, Don't Eat the Yellow Snow, was the first of Zappa's three Billboard Top 100 hits. Ultimately, it peaked at number 86, but the album became the biggest commercial success of Zappa's career, reaching number 10 on the U.S. Billboard 200. So do yourself a favor and pick this up this weekend. Give it a spin. This has been Vinyl and 45 on 107.7 RKR.
I would like to take this opportunity to express my fondness for a beer.
Good morning, my fellow Americans. It's Friday.
It's time to crack the first beer of the weekend with the Rocker Morning Show and Presidential Brewing Company.
On 107.7 RKR.
The Rocker.
Woo-woo!
Hey. Yeah, baby!
Oh, the party's here now.
That's it right. Is. Jake in the house from Presidential Brewing. What's up, man?
Here I am. Glad to be here, guys. I'm excited for this weekend, and I'm excited to bring you guys Sherbert Hoover Prickly Pear today.
Crack that one on the mic.
So, yeah, we better get this thing started. Now, what you guys can't see through the radio is that this beer is like this weird, like pretty pink color.
It's gorgeous.
It looks like pink lemonade.
It really, it's just a gorgeous beer, and that's the Prickly Pear showing through. Whenever we make our Sherbert Hoover, we use real fruit puree, and there's like 210 pounds of
Gosh.
Of prickly pear in this beer. So I hope you like prickly pear, y'all.
Yeah. What's interesting is, you know, we had my folks here a while back, and I believe that was the day that we were doing the orange creamsicle Sherbert Hoover. And we ran out of it before my folks got there, so they had the mystery beer out of the fridge, which I believe was a double IPA.
Yeah, I'm pretty sure it was.
Neither one of them like IPAs.
Which is perfect.
Yeah, so it doubled down on it. So I compensated, and when we went on our vacation last week, I brought them this beer.
Oh, cool.
And they were ecstatic.
Nice.
They loved this one.
Yeah, this one's a ton of fun. This is a silly kind of beer. I never intended to make sour beer at the brewery.
Yeah.
So this is a kettle sour. This is the most mild of all the different kinds of sours that you can really get. And what I like about this is it's got a nice clean finish. It doesn't really hit you in the corner of your jaws all that much.
Mm-hmm.
But it's like, it just kind of complements the fruit profile. It's a fruit level of sour. So it's not super aggressive. And so I think we should probably just give this
cheers,
thing a taste.
Cheers, everybody. Yeah, cheers.
Sample, yeah.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, so the prickly pear really shines on this one. We do use a little bit of vanilla with that as well. And
I get that.
So you tie all that together and you're like, I could drink this.
This
just
is,
about any time.
I always compliment you on your sours because, like, normally people make sours and you get that tartness that makes it kind of pucker a little bit. It's so subtle on these that even if you like sweeter beers and you're not a fan of the tart stuff, like, this is the way to go. Like,
yeah, the key is really, it's just balance, right?
Mm-hmm.
You want that balance, and there is sour in there. When you drink it, you're like, oh, yeah, there's sour. And then, there is sweet. So it's just kind of finding that balance between those two spaces. And this one has worked out really well. A big shout-out to our original brewer, Ryan, when he convinced me to make a kettle sour when I never wanted to. So this has been one of our top sellers since we first released it. So we do this in several different kinds of flavors. This one we've got prickly pear on right now, but the one in the fermenters right now is pina colada. That one's to be showing up soon here.
All right. Okay.
Somebody's got to call our. We're missing a member of our woo crew that popped in here.
I saw her.
Robin.
Where'd Robin go?
Yeah.
We saw Robin walk by the door.
Hey, I'm curious, Jake. The last beer that you brought in last week, it was kind of a more of a. Which one was that?
That was the coffee blonde, wasn't it? Fake Bruce?
Yes. Yeah.
So I'm curious about this too. Is like, have you ever put the prickly pear one in like a slushy form?
Oh, we've definitely done this in slushy form.
Awesome.
We've done a lot of different things with this beer. We've also made ice cream with Sherbert Hoover.
This would be really great.
So that one's a ton of fun too.
Oh.
And
the whole room.
And then
just lost it.
Last year we actually did this with peanut peanut butter in it, and we called it Sherbert Goober.
oh, my gosh.
Yeah, so peanut butter and jelly beer.
Beautiful.
It's a ton. We have fun with our beers over there.
Oh, well, you're going to have fun tonight because the Prickly Pear is half off your first pour out in this bad boy at Presidential Brewing Company.
50% off the first pour tonight, and you should stick around for the music. We've got some really great entertainment lined up this weekend. Tonight is the Megan Ray Band.
Ooh,
if you've never seen them, make sure you get out and watch that band. They're just incredible. Mm-hmm. Tomorrow night, we've got a new one, Allie Garland and With Awesome Sauce. Local bands, they're coming out of Battle Creek. And then Sunday, we actually have a big, big comedy show with Zane Lamprey, who used to star on Three Sheets. He's coming to town. This is his third time back at Presidential. There's still tickets available for that, so check out presidentialbrewing.com and get your tickets to the show this Sunday.
In fact, we're going to give you a $20 gift certificate, as always, to Presidential Brewing Company right now. On top of that, we're going to give you VIP tickets to the show tonight and the show tomorrow to caller number 7-978-1077. Caller number 7, let's hook you up with a $20 gift certificate to Presidential Brewing Company. Get you some tickets to these sweet shows coming up tonight and tomorrow. And get you half off that first pour of Prickly Pear that'll pulverize your palate to pieces.
That was pretty.
Cheers.
I missed this bit. All right. Cheers, everybody, to the first beer of the weekend.